The Juju Smith-Schuster takes have gotten way out of hand. It's quite embarrassing, to be honest. I've never seen a player who is so unproblematic on and off the field receive such hatred and vitriol from fans of both opposing teams and the Steelers themselves. Like, it's gotten to the point where people would rather side with Antonio Brown, you know, the guy with a sexual assault accusation to his name, among other things, and also the guy who threw away his legacy because he was upset that his teammate was voted team MVP over him. Yep, these days people would rather get more worked up over a 10-second dance during pre-game warm-ups because apparently everyone, even people my age, turn into boomers who hate all things fun when TikTok is involved. He's been called everything in the book from a diva wide receiver to AB 2.0, even despite the fact that while he's been misused and underutilized all season, he has never once complained. It's disrespectful when Juju dances during pregame, but it's savage when Ravens players run out to midfield to celebrate in the middle of a game. I don't care about either one personally, but the hypocrisy is staggering. And sure, people will say, but the Ravens won, so they can do it. But what about the 11 times Juju did it to start the year and wins? They say he doesn't care about football and that he should just focus on producing instead of making money for himself. Do these people know how little time it takes to film a TikTok? Juju is having fun, entertaining kids, and securing the bag all while still doing his job. There should be no problem. But then he goes out and puts up 13 catches and a buck 54, and people still bash him for a 1 second dance prior to a play in the second half, as if players don't do all kinds of dances to hype themselves up during games. Sure, his comment about the Browns prior to the Steelers' wildcard loss was ill-advised, even if it was nothing to fret about when it was actually put into context, but people had already long since made up their mind on him at that point. But I digress. Bulletin board material is overrated. The Browns playing their division rival on the road in their first playoff game in 18 years already had enough motivation to win the game. Juju's dancing and manufactured trash talking isn't why the Steelers lost this game or any of their past four losses. His Corvette isn't what caused Marquise Pouncey to snap the ball over his quarterback's head or Ben Roethlisberger to throw four picks. Regardless, everybody's made up their mind about this one way or another. I'm not here to change that. My actual issue is that people have allowed their dislike for the man off the field to bleed into their opinion of him as a player, to the point where people actually think he's a trash player just because his fantasy stats aren't through the roof, because they don't look at context. Let's break it all down, shall we? Juju was drafted in the second round in 2017 out of USC and instantly exploded, going for 917 yards on 58 grabs and 7 scores in 14 games, outshining incumbent number 2 Martavis Bryant, who requested a trade mid-season out of jealousy, which he was granted after the season. With Bryant in Oakland in 2018, Smith-Schuster took his game to a new level, leading the team in both receptions and yards. Before Justin Jefferson this season, Juju was the youngest player to ever record a 1,400-yard season. That's no fluke. Smith-Schuster's efforts were rewarded as he was named team MVP, which upset Antonio Brown so much that he sat out a pivotal Week 17 game and forced his way out of Pittsburgh with a public meltdown of epic proportions, which included throwing Juju under the bus. With Brown also traded to Oakland, 2019 was supposed to be the year Juju proved he could hold his own as a number one wide receiver. But when Big Ben went down in Week 2 and the Steelers were stuck with Mason Rudolph and Duck Hodges at quarterback, any hopes for that instantly went in the gutter. Still, even while catching passes from the worst quarterback tandem in the league and fighting through a Week 1 toe injury, Smith-Schuster was on pace for over 1,000 yards and 6 touchdowns in 2019 through 8 weeks. But he later missed a month with a concussion and wound up receiving almost 100 fewer targets than he had in the previous year. No one should question anything about how that season turned out. But now we get to 2020. With Roethlisberger back healthy and more experienced secondary weapons, this was supposed to be the year. So what happened? Juju's line of 97, 831, and 9 is respectable, even if the yards per catch number is underwhelming. After having long plays of 97, 97, and 76 yards in his first 3 years, Juju's longest gain in 2020 went for just 31 yards. Was Juju exposed as a fraud? Was he only good because of AB? Did he somehow lose all his burst? I hate to burst your bubble, but the answer to all of those questions is no. The issue, like most of the Steelers in 2020, came down to quarterback play, offensive scheme, and play calling. Yep. Whereas Roethlisberger was undeniably an upgrade on Rudolph and Hodges, he did not come close to matching his high level of play from the past that he was expected to. His accuracy was all over the map, especially on deep balls, as he ranked just 28th in completion percentage over expected. This, along with the fact that the Steelers had no running game, led Randy Fignor to employ a quick short passing game at nearly all times. As defenses quickly adjusted to the most predictable offense in the NFL, the Steelers stuck with it until the very end, leading to disastrous results down the stretch. With Juju working as the slot man, he saw the brunt of it. Not only was he set up to fail in this offense, but he was set up to be killed. Juju had the second lowest average depth of target of any eligible receiver at a measly 5.5 average. Even the ghost of Larry Fitzgerald saw more than that. Meanwhile, this was almost half of the A-dot Juju saw in each of the first 3 years of his career. He was also 109th out of 112 receivers this season in terms of yards before contact per reception. He was given short catch after short catch and was expected to make something out of nothing every single time he touched the ball, even though the defense knew exactly what was coming. Even a receiver as physical as Juju, who has gotten Hines Ward comparisons for obvious reasons, should not be expected to do that time and time again. And it's not as if he's just an unskilled catch and fall receiver either, as he gained more yards after the catch per reception in 2020 than a receiver in his position would have been expected to, per Next Gen Stats. The Steelers just refused to use Smith-Schuster in ways that would be optimal for both him and the team. A mere 8.0% of Juju's targets were 20 or more yards down the field in 2020, good for the lowest mark in the league. He caught all four of his deep targets that PFF deemed catchable for 101 yards and 2 scores. The other 6 were all misses by Big Ben. His 8.0 deep percentage was another steep drop-off from previous years. He finished 7th, 10th, and 12th in deep percentages respectively in the past 3 years, with marks all above 14%. Juju was never a true speed demon burner a la DeSean Jackson, but he was still a great deep threat, which the Steelers decided to take away from him for whatever reason. But it's not just deep shots that were taken away from him either. Smith-Schuster was basically eliminated in the intermediate area too in 2020. Despite seeing 128 targets, only an embarrassingly low 31 of those passes went 10 or more yards down the field. That's a paltry 24.2%. Over 3/4 of Juju's targets were within 10 yards of the line of scrimmage, and people still wonder why he had a single-digit yards per catch mark. He had between a 39 and 46% mark of those targets from 2017 to 2019. Juju saw just 2 fewer targets in that area of the field in 2019, despite missing a quarter of the season and playing on a team that threw almost 150 fewer passes. But do you want to know the saddest part? After seeing a meager 31 passes 10 or more yards down the field in the 2020 regular season, Juju saw 11 alone in the wildcard game versus Cleveland. That's more than double his next highest total of the season. And lo and behold, he had his most productive game in over 2 years, going for 157 yards on 13 grabs with a score. Weird how putting your best players in situations to succeed works. And before you mention it, it was not due to prevent defense. Prevent defense is the most misused term in football, right beside double teams. There may have been some slightly softer coverages, but Juju is still finding the perfect holes in the zone and making tough contested catches. But it was too little too late for the Steelers to finally open up their offense and give their number one receiver some freedom, and for that, Pittsburgh is going home. That may have been the final game in a Steelers uniform for Smith-Schuster as he enters free agency this spring. I doubt NFL teams are like the NFL fans who don't actually watch the games and think Juju's a terrible player just because of his box score stats, but if they are, some team will get a massive bargain. The quarterback play in Pittsburgh has degraded from elite in 2017 to downright terrible the past 2 seasons, and the horrible system under Fignor can no longer be hidden. As a Steelers fan myself, I would like to see the team re-sign Juju because I appreciate what he's done for the team, but I would rather he find a team that actually plays to his strengths, and with everything still in place in Pittsburgh, I fail to see that happening there anytime soon. Hate on the man all you want for being Gen Z, but don't let that cloud your vision of him as a player. In a system that doesn't treat him like a running back out of the backfield, Juju Smith-Schuster will flourish and show what he has already proven himself capable of once again.